Good morning. By now you know my name as Bishop James, and I am not stranger to this church because in 2006 and 7 I was an associate pastor in St. Felicitas Church, San Leandro. So I used to come here for confessions, for mass sometimes, and then I have another association with this church because 2 years ago one of my priests, Father George Kedulu or George Angami, was here for summer ministry. Therefore, Holy Spirit Church is quite familiar to us of the Diocese of Kohima. Well, before I begin my appeal to the mission appeal, let me begin with a joke that I often do. You know, once there was a little problem between the bishop and one of the priests, as often sometimes happens. And the bishop said to the priest, "Come on, let us get it over. Come to the bishop's house, we shall have a dinner and talk over." So the priest came at 5 o'clock, appointed time, rang the bell, and then the receptionist came out and saw the priest standing out. So she asked him, "Father, what can I do for you?" And he said, "You know, I have an appointment with the bishop at 5 o'clock. I came for that appointment." Well, the receptionist said, "I'm very sorry. This morning we got the news that the bishop is transferred, moved to another diocese, and therefore he has cancelled all appointments." Well, the priest went away. After 5 minutes, there was again the bell. So the receptionist came out and looked and saw the same priest standing out. And so she asked him, "Father, what can I do for you?" And he said, "You know, I have an appointment with the bishop at 5. I came for that appointment." And then she said, "I told you, Father, that we got the news that the bishop is transferred and therefore he has cancelled all appointments." Well, he smiled and went away. After 5 minutes, there was again the bell. So the receptionist came out and looked, and the same priest is standing outside. So she asked him, "Father, what can I do for you now?" Then he said, "You know, I came for that appointment at 5 o'clock with the bishop." She was a little annoyed and said, "I told you already that he is transferred and he has cancelled all appointments. Why do you come again and again?" And he said, "I want to hear the good news again and again." Well, we are all here to hear the good news, but not good news about the transfer, but about the Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the greatest good news. And the gospel of today very clearly tells us who Jesus is. Now, Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do people say I am?" They said he is one of the prophets, John the Baptist, etc. But Jesus was not satisfied. He said, "Who do you say I am? You, individually." And Peter said, "You are the Messiah, you are the Son of God." And this is the greatest good news. Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus is the Son of God. For each one of us, he is our personal Savior. And this is the news that we are called to proclaim, called to live. We live it by our own lives as Christians, by our own life of witness. We proclaim it by our own life of witness. And of course, that some churches like a mission diocese like Kohima proclaims to people who do not know who Jesus is. We proclaim to them saying that he is the Savior. In him, you have the fullness of life. As St. John would say, "God so loved the world that he gave his own Son so that we may have life and his fullness." And the Diocese of Kohima does that very actively, very fervently. You know, the Diocese of Kohima, again, geographically it is situated in the northeastern part of India, northeast extreme, bordering Myanmar. And the Catholic Church came by chance to that region. In the sense, you know, the British did not, or rather favored, non-Catholic denominations to evangelize the northeastern part of India because that part is mostly tribal. Many tribes live there. And the American Baptists had come around 1840, around that time. And they had evangelized the whole region, American Baptists, there is Presbyterians, the Anglicans, the Lutherans, etc. But the Catholic Church was not favored. Well, the Assistant Catholic Church came to Nagaland by chance because, you know, if you know the history of the Second World War, the last battle of the Second World War was in the East, was fought in Kohima. I'm sure some of you have seen the film called The Bridge on the River Kwai. It is related to this advancement of the Allied forces. Now, it is said that the Japanese had crossed over Myanmar and attacked the British, what you call, military camp in Kohima. And it is said that more than 3,000 Allied soldiers were killed. And if you come to Kohima today, you will find a beautiful war cemetery maintained by the Commonwealth. At the entrance of this cemetery, it is written these words: "When you go home, tell of us that for your tomorrow we gave our today." Beautiful words. When you go home, tell of us that for your tomorrow we gave our today. Now, as a reward for helping during this battle, the British government built a hospital for the local people called the Naga Hospital. And 1947, 48, 49, to run that hospital, there was nobody. So the governor of the state, who was a Muslim actually, requested the archbishop in another city called Shillong whether he could find out some religious sisters or nuns or they call brothers to run this hospital. And he managed to get two sisters from Spain belonging to the congregation of the Missionaries of Christ Jesus to run the hospital. And they came in 1949 along with an Italian Salesian priest, Monsignor Bars. But they were told not to teach Catholic faith. And the sisters write in their memoirs or in their diary that whenever they got a chance to get out of the hospital, they used to bury medals, crucifixes under the mud, hoping that the church will grow, Catholic Church will grow. And that's what happened. In 1952, they went away, 1952 December. But before they went, they reaped the first harvest. They were able to baptize five youth into Catholic Church. So that was the first baptism in Nagaland, 1952 December. Since then, the church has growing steadily. Catholic Church have been growing steadily. Today we have about 60,000 Catholics managed or looked after by 38 full-fledged parishes and 13 mission stations. And as I said, Father George, who came here 2 years ago, belonged to one of the tribes called Angami. And Nagaland is inhabited by 16 major tribes. And each of these tribes have their own tradition, their own culture, their own customs. And the English is a common language because of that. So Nagaland have English as a common language, just like other countries. And as I said, since the mission is growing every year, it calls for building up the mission stations. So our basic mission work, definitely along with education and pastoral work, is also building up the infrastructure. A new mission means a presbytery or a priest house, a church, a convent, a school. And education is one of our main apostolates, because through education we know we can change, transform people's mind as well as develop their people. And again, one of my priorities as a bishop is that we build some hostels for people to come and stay, students. You know, the parishes are in the main cities. We have villages with the Catholic communities sometimes 5, 10, 15, 20 kilometers away. So they cannot come to the school every day from the villages. So we try to bring the children into the parish, provide them with a dormitory to sleep, a place to study, a study hall and a toilet facility. And we request the parents to bring the provisions, the food. So the parents come walking sometimes 20, 30 kilometers once a week or once in 2 months or once a month, give them the rice and vegetable, and the children themselves cook and then attend the school. So you'll find them age of 5 up to 15 cooking their own food and going to the school. And therefore, this is one of my priority in order to build hostels so that they can attend the school and thus make a living for themselves. Another specific project I have in mind is to build an orphanage for boys and girls who are affected by, or rather left orphans by, HIV positive or the drug addiction. Again, you might know what you call the golden triangle of the drug trafficking is coming from Indonesia, from Thailand to Myanmar, and then through Northeast India and to the rest of the world. The Northeast East India is the road or the route on which the drug is passed on. And therefore, a lot of people are affected by drug addiction and then they die very young, leaving their children orphans. So the Sisters of the Carmelite Order looks after the girls and the diocese try to look after the boys. So I like to build specifically an orphanages for these two groups of boys and girls so that they have a chance for making a good living by attending the school and then getting themselves successful in their life. So this is my specific appeal for which I make my mission appeal these days. And I like to thank you in a very, very special way for your generosity in anticipation and pray that God may bless you. As I said, for us, the good news is Jesus Christ. We must make known Jesus as the Son of God by your life, by your witness, and what we do. And I pray that this parish, the Holy Spirit parish, truly become a witnesses of this, as I see a prayer that is said every day here, that we become truly witnesses of Jesus Christ becoming an amazing parish. And I pray that God may bless you in this effort to proclaim and live the mystery of the faith that Jesus is our Lord and Master. God bless you.